Hachette Audio presents Drug Warrior, Inside the Hunt for El Chapo and the Rise of America's Opioid Crisis. Written by Jack Riley with Mitch Weiss. Read by Brett Barry. To my wife, Monica, and son, Kevin, for their unwavering love and support. Author's note. This is the story of a group of extraordinary men and women who not only hunted down and captured one of the world's most dangerous drug lords, but fight every day to keep us safe at home and around the globe. The events depicted in this book are seen through my eyes and based on my extensive experience in the Drug Enforcement Administration. The story is told as honestly and faithfully as I can. I can do no more than that. And in honor of my fallen law enforcement comrades, I can do no less. Many people have heard of Joaquin El Chapo Guzman Loera and the dangerous drug cartels that threaten our nation's security. But few know the behind-the-scenes details of the manhunt, or the partisan politics that impede our nation's ability to effectively deal with the drug crisis that has destroyed so many families. This book is intended to tell that story. The secret is to work less as individuals and more as a team. As a coach, I play not my 11 best, but my best 11. Knut Rockne. Prologue. The Chase, 2007. My brand new Chevy roared north through the dark toward Las Cruces and home, the Notre Dame fight song blasting on the CD player. But it was hard to concentrate on the song. My eyes kept shifting between the dark road and the pickup truck and SUV tailing me. I was driving a 2007 Chevrolet Impala, black. In my rearview mirror, I saw a late model Ford F-150 pickup truck, navy blue, and a Ford Explorer, black. Ours were the only six headlights along this lonely stretch of Interstate 10. I pushed the accelerator toward the floor and watched the needle pass 100 miles an hour. Intelligence reports said Joaquin El Chapo Guzman Loera, infamous drug lord, head of the deadly Sinaloa cartel, had put a price on my head shortly after I had taken over as the DEA special agent in charge of El Paso. Now I had hitmen on my tail. My headlights didn't reach far into the darkness. I couldn't remember how far it was to the next exit. All I knew was I had to keep driving until I came up with a plan. My family's life might be at stake. My own life depended on it. El Chapo was the most dangerous drug trafficker in the world, and I'd been busting his balls since I got to El Paso, one of the biggest Drug Enforcement Administration territories in the United States. I'd been tracking Guzman since my days with the DEA Special Operations Unit. I wanted the job in El Paso, so I'd be on the front lines in the fight against Guzman's massive organization. So why did I think he wouldn't come after me? I was already in a hurry when I left my office. My wife and son were waiting for me at home. For security's sake, we didn't live in El Paso. Instead, we'd moved to a quiet neighborhood in Las Cruces, New Mexico, about 40 miles northwest of the border. It was a long commute, but I wanted my family as far from the action as I could keep them. The move was hard. My son was getting ready to start high school in St. Louis, Missouri, and we'd taken him from his friends. But I knew things were getting better when he burned a CD for me with all my favorite country artists, Merle Haggard, Willie Nelson, Waylon Jennings. And right toward the middle, Kevin added a surprise, the Notre Dame fight song. I popped in my custom CD every night on the long drive home. I first spotted the pickup truck and Ford Explorer as I approached the interstate on-ramp. They sat side by side in the parking lot of a fast food place, their vehicles pointed in opposite directions so the drivers could talk to each other. Cops in unmarked cars, I thought. But as soon as I got onto the highway, they rolled out of the parking lot and followed me. It just didn't look right, I thought. No one heads north that time of night. There's nothing between El Paso and Las Cruces, except a couple of bullshit gas and burrito exits. Something didn't feel right. I punched the accelerator and felt the big engine kick in. Soon I was going 100 miles an hour, but the pickup truck and Ford Explorer were right on top of me. Every time I slowed down, they slowed down. Every time I accelerated, they accelerated. When the pickup truck sped by, I noticed it had no license plates. "Whoa!
Holy shit," I said.
Then the fight song came on the stereo. I grabbed my BlackBerry and fumbled with the keyboard until I somehow managed to punch in the number for Mike, one of my agents who lived close to my neighborhood. He answered his phone, and all he could hear was the Notre Dame fight song. "What the hell?" he said. I paused the music. "Mike, get to my house. Get to the front of my house. I don't want my wife to know you're there, but they gotta know that you're there." I didn't have to say another word. Mike understood that my family might be in danger. "Got it." I hung up and called my best friend, Tony, who had just retired from the DEA. We'd been together as agents on the streets of Chicago. He was the godfather of my only child. Tony answered on the second ring.
"You've only been there a couple of months. How'd you piss these people off that fast?" he said, in a thick Chicago accent.
"I don't know. I guess I move fast."
"You must be doing something right," he said.
But this wasn't a time to catch up. I told Tony about the Ford Explorer on my back bumper and the pickup truck in the lane in front of me.
"Look, you gotta get to the police station," he said.
"You don't get it. I got 30 miles of desert on each side, and these scumbags are on me. This isn't Chicago where you drive a few blocks and you're at a police station. There's nothing I can do."
"Turn your lights and sirens on."
"They haven't installed them in this car yet. I don't even have a police radio."
"What the hell are you driving that for?"
"Because it's brand new." I could tell Tony was worried. "Listen, I don't really know the area, but I think the Doña Ana County Sheriff's Department is somewhere up the road, past Las Cruces," I said.
"How far?"
25, 30 miles.
"Just keep driving. Get to the Sheriff's Department. Get to the damn Sheriff's Department."
I placed my BlackBerry on the passenger seat, pushed the play button on the stereo, and focused on the road. The Ford Explorer pulled a little closer to my back bumper, almost hitting me. It held steady there, while the pickup truck in the lane in front of me started slowing down. My mind went to the Glock strapped to my left ankle and one spare magazine with 8 rounds in my glove compartment. Not a lot of firepower. I pulled hard on the wheel, hit the gas, and accelerated past the pickup. I was jumping off the next exit and taking these bastards for a ride. At the stop sign at the end of the exit ramp, I turned left and headed west on Roadrunner Drive, toward a cluster of homes. I glimpsed in the rearview mirror and the headlights were still behind me. I was driving 60 miles an hour, zigzagging up and down streets in residential neighborhoods, but I just couldn't shake them. When I spotted a playground parking lot, I pulled to the back. There was no outrunning them. I shut off the music, killed the headlights. The lot was dark. I grabbed the extra magazine from the glove box, wishing I had my shotgun, and jumped out of the car. I squatted behind the engine block and waited. I knew I was outgunned, outmanned, but I wasn't going to let these jagoffs take me down without a fight. Chapter 1. Glory Days, 1986. This was it. After days of careful planning, everything was set. The location, the drugs, the money. I hung up the phone on the nightstand and took a deep breath. Time to get ready. I slipped on a white Ralph Lauren shirt and crisp khaki pants. I tugged on the shoelaces of my topsider boat shoes to make sure they were tight. I stepped in front of the mirror. My face was shaved smooth, and every strand of my short reddish-brown hair was in place. I put on my fake Rolex and Ray-Bans and became John Lynch. It was close to 6 p.m. on a crisp autumn night in 1986. I was an undercover street agent for the Drug Enforcement Administration, so most of my days started when everybody else was headed home. For weeks, I had been hanging around seedy beer-and-a-shot bars in the working-class Chicago suburb of Roselle, Illinois, trying to buy cocaine. That's how I met Mike Rizzo, a burly laborer with a big black pompadour and a porno mustache. He introduced himself one night while I was sitting at a bar, nursing a Miller Lite. Rizzo was a roofer. divorced. He sold drugs on the side to help make ends meet. Got 3 kids. You know how that is, right? He said, before lifting a cold bottle of Budweiser to his lips. I nodded. I started small, buying nickel and dime bags of cocaine from Rizzo. When I had earned his trust, I confessed that I was looking for a bigger score. Not a problem, he bragged, and he kept his promise. Now I was about to drive an hour west to downtown Roselle to meet him in a furniture store parking lot. He had 5 ounces of Colombian cocaine, and I had a gym bag with $10,000 inside. I'd been on the job for a year. Undercover work was risky, so I planned every detail in advance, no surprises. I had to know where the deal was going to take place. My team had to know the signal I'd use to alert them to arrest the dealer after I bought the dope, something as simple as putting on my sunglasses or taking off my baseball cap. And I had to stick to the script. So, like Robert De Niro and Taxi Driver, I recited my lines over and over in front of the bathroom mirror until I slipped into character. Forget about Jack Riley, a tough-talking hotshot DEA agent. I was John Lynch, a trust fund yuppie. My father was a millionaire lawyer, and I was in the real estate business. I'd heard how lucrative cocaine was, and I was preparing to do a little dealing myself, just among my friends. But the act was more than just remembering my backstory. I had to constantly remind myself of the little things. I had to pay attention to what I said.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.